Haji the Dingo was born in this desert, which he had made his home and that of his children, Waka and Kintala. Paraji was a good father for the family. He spared his children from the harshness of going hungry thanks to his accumulated supplies of meat, which he had hidden in various places. At the south of this world, we found Kangaroo Island, bathed in fresh waters. On the shore where his mother Burka had gone, the young Yam, a western gray kangaroo, tasted seawater and discovered the strange flavors of seaweed which had been washed ashore. In the inland, a female koala began pursuing a dominant male, Mako, and discovered the pain and pleasure of this union. All this Paraji projected on the Dome of Dreams. For it is in this manner we enter life when our dream begins. Here in the north of Australia, the waters mingle with the earth. It is the most humid region of a continent nevertheless reputed to be the driest in the world. Once each year, the monsoons pour out flood tides from the heavens. There we find numerous estuaries where the tides mix fresh and salt water at will. This environment has promoted a rich ecosystem where birds, turtles, and other reptiles prosper. There is not just one coast where birds such as the pied oyster catcher who hunts for shellfish, or where marine turtles haven't placed their eggs. It's a windfall for crooks, borrowers, and robbers of every kind. On this beach reigns one of these such thieves, a dragon called a Varanus, who will soon climb out of his burrow where he has spent the night. The great reptile, a sand monitor, is just beginning to wake up from his lethargic state. The sun's rays are indispensable to his scaly body. Essentially, the Varanus is a cold-blooded animal. Unlike mammals, he does not produce his own thermal energy and depends on his environment for that. Having recharged all of his biological batteries, Min starts an inspection of his property. He trudges along heavily, for his body is massive and his limbs must exude great strength to support him on top of the ground. Yet in spite of his mass, the sand monitor is capable of running when he has to. This rapidity has given him the nickname Varanus the Racehorse. It's good that he belongs to one of the most intelligent species of Varanus. Min doesn't have much of a sense of adaptation. He proceeds to turn around in a repetitive and limited manner. A sandy hole in which not long ago he devoured a turtle's egg will be newly inspected day after day, as if the egg had the power to grow again, like a fruit. Min never changes his routine on the beach. Sometimes a surprise, more or less edible. Seaweed, a dead bird, or a scrap from the sea will introduce a spark of fantasy into the reptilian brain of the starved, mechanical, obscure, and primitive Varanus, where the light penetrates sparingly. Still, several flicks of the tongue, the organ that contributes as much to his sense of smell as to his taste, to determine interest in a found object. And then he must turn back towards the bushes of the shore, where perhaps he will find better fortune. In the eucalyptus grove of Kangaroo Island, a female koala named Kakira is helping her six-month-old baby discover the world. It's the first time that he is perched as such on the head of his mother, having thrown into the mane of Kakira his already powerful claws. Kakira gave birth to him 35 days after having been conceived. The embryo, seeing that marsupials are not born as completed creatures, crawled into the jungle of maternal fur just to get to the pouch. He only resembled a larva at this point, a pink bean, less than 2 centimeters long. Hanging on to one of 2 teats, he completed his development in a shadowy light until the second birth around 5 months. Then he had to, for the first time, slide his nose towards the light outside. Far from the freshness of the eucalyptus, the true Australia is a spot of blood that oozes from the sky. Of the great central desert, one says it is a scarlet heart, and with each beat it fathers a divinity, a myth, a dream. We call it the Red Heart. The earth and the desert sand are filled with laterite, a geological material resulting from the oxidation of iron and aluminum. It's also laterite that produces the red glow of the tropical zones of Africa and South America, joined to Australia in the past on the same continental plate, the Gondwana. Canyons. Craters, meteorites, shattered rocks. For the Aborigines, the real men, the chaos of this relief corresponds to that of our emotions. The first beings were dominated by them and were petrified here to remind us that life is only but a dream, a lake of pure sand that nothing should disturb. Paraji the dingo belongs to a wandering and disparaging species. But he has wed the desert, and this latter has taught him foresight. Under a coat of sand, Paraji has built up a reserve of food that he digs up when hunger bothers and agitates his children, the young male Kintala and his sister Waka. With wise management, Paraji takes enough for his needs. He masters time and could slow down the shortage if the game is made scarce. Waka, the young female, is greedier and quicker than her brother, Kintala, and she will leave him only with his mouth watering and the right for him to be envious. The meat is firm and cured just as she likes it. It is a scrap pulled out from the carcass of a very young kangaroo, who Paraji and other acquaintances had hunted a few days earlier. The dingo's diet is three-quarters mammals, such as kangaroos, wombats, rabbits, or rats. He likes to kill them himself, but he would gladly transform into a vulture if he found a creature already dead. By eating before her brother, Waka takes ascendance over him. By means of simple intimidation, she forces him to check his impatience. Strength counts for nothing. In the desert, survival is also a question of attitude. Waka takes pleasure in mocking Kintala, tempting him to swallow his pride. And when Kintala, who is on the left, has finally been allowed to share the booty, it's only because his sister wants to be charitable to him. Paraji doesn't care about these quarrels. They will forge the character of his children. For it will be necessary for them to live on the burning sands of life, as much as to learn toughness and duplicity, to be initiated into violence as well as cunning. Nevertheless, the times are not destitute. The desert is dry, even if it's less in this season than during the dry season, but it's not empty. So much is illusion. Here the dream is life, and the life awakening. That which is full is an abyss, and that which is empty is fulfilled. But in order to make a distinction around Mount Artula, between that which palpitates, runs and is eaten, and trembling mirages that the earth vaporizes, we should have the eye of an eagle. The wedge-tailed eagle is an eagle of great size, whose wingspan can surpass 2 meters. There is nothing he hates more than these dense forests, whose coverage protects his prey. The sky of the savannah is his kingdom by election. If he flies alone, it's because he's hunting. If he flies with another, it's because he's proclaiming ownership over a territory. If he flies in a group, it's because his clan hopes to spot a prey of great size. For the wedge-tailed eagles, waltzers carried by hot air that rises from the earth, it's a euphoric season. The females will soon lay 1 or 2 eggs in a nest of branches perched high at the top of a rocky crag or at the edge of a rocky cliff. That's why it is necessary to become strong and stuff oneself with rodents, reptiles, or birds easily caught in full flight. The bird sometimes stops, as if shattered by his own liberty. Then the hunt restarts and he lies in wait for his game. Hatch, fly, kill. With the eagles of the desert, the waltz is in 3-time. In the great estuary of the north, where Min the Varanus lives, there is a crack in the landscape, scarred, scaly, and bronzed. The largest crocodile in the world inspects the sector. His length can surpass 7 meters, and his weight 900 kilos. He is voracious and powerful. It's the saltwater crocodile. He is as happy in freshwater as in seawater, and that's why he has the nickname Salty. He frequented the original continent during the time of the dinosaurs. His shape has remained stable for 200 million years. The presence of Salty is not so strange to Min the Varanus. He likes to search the grasses and waters of the bank, where he swallows eggs and kills little mammals. Sometimes even the crocodiles could disregard due to a lack of hunger, the tips of the guts or the intestines pulled out from the prey they have drowned. The two animals are fond of the same territory. One day, their face-to-face encounters will turn sour. Min does not feel that his size makes him able to confront this most frightening of predators. He retraces his steps. Suddenly, Min stops. His tongue turns up towards his organ of smell, situated in his mouth, a bulb of deliciously fetid odors. The repeated passing of a wedge-tailed eagle confirms the impression of the Varanus. A cadaver is found within his reach. The carrion is that of a wallaby, a marsupial close to the kangaroo, but of less weight. It weighs probably 15 to 20 kilos. Green flies have already started to suck the sap and lay their eggs. Before Min has approached them, the eagle has landed. He has only a few moments in order to pillage some fragments of the treasure. Already the Varanus extracts himself from this aroma of soaked flesh, which is not enough for him. At present, Min wants to tear up this cadaver with his teeth, of which the warmth will reheat the throat and the tripe for him. The forked tongue, like that of a serpent, flicks. This gives the animal some information about the chemical composition of the air, if he is in the presence of predators or females, and about the nature of each scented particle. Min's tongue supplies, in packets of odors, a specialized sensor called Jacobson's organ. One could say that the Varanus sees with his tongue, like others see with their eyes. The Varanus has five fingers on each paw, sharp claws like swords. Moving by the impressive muscle structure of his limbs, his extremities turn into a true machine that can rip meat apart. Then his jaws start into action. They are full of small but sharp teeth, slanted backwards. They seize their food and mechanically direct it to the bottom of the gillet. Min does not know which end to start on. This mass is too big for him. Nevertheless, the Varanus is the only saurian whose lower jaw drops down like that of a serpent and allows the passage of prey of disproportionate sizes. His skull is totally ossified in order to contain the pressure caused by these motions. But this device becomes a disadvantage when a carrion cannot even enter the mouth and cannot be dismembered even by shaking it. Min explores again the entrails and the limbs of the wallaby with the care of an anatomist. Decidedly, the meat is too fresh, too firm, and too dense. The Varanus is growing impatient. He attacks the superficial muscles of the carrion, which are certainly more accessible. Perplexed, Min moves away from his prey, as if he was abandoning it. The Varanus drinks and catches his breath. Suddenly, a white-bellied sea eagle, with incredible recklessness, seizes a fish right in front of the nose of a crocodile. Without even interrupting his flight, a wedge-tailed eagle pinches some fibers of flesh that Min had detached from the carcass. Tired of seeing others finding his food at their convenience, Min comes back to the table. The wallaby, already dead, will not know the additional problem of feeling alone. Already the eagle comes to keep him company and to surround him with his care. He pecks, here and there, a piece of guts, a fragment of spleen, just until Min, the Varanus, adopts a more aggressive posture. The reptile doesn't want to leave this meat here, which after several hours of decomposition will render it more tender and more docile. The occasion is too great. The annual food ration of a Varanus is only 5 times his own weight. This unexpected wallaby will fill a great part of Min's needs. It suffices for the present to put it in a safe place and to wait until the weather and the bacteria have rendered it edible. Min transforms himself into a tractor, a task for which his strength has predestined him and is comparable to that of a young buffalo. The moon will look after the carrion while waiting for the Varanus to digest it. At the end of the day, each atom of the wallaby will grow in the great reserve of matter where it will give birth to other lives. The dream has aggregated this dust. It will return to the consciousness who fathered the world, and this mystery will be accomplished in accordance to the real men in the heart of the night, populated by dragons. The squirrel glider haunts the same night, sculpted on a tree like the relief of a totem pole. His lower incisors are very sharp. He has torn apart the bark in order to let the sap, which nourishes him, run out. The little arboreal marsupial sets out to search for other saps, other nectar. He hesitates. Should he start with the same tree, or should he change suppliers? Soon, the animal makes a decision. He will explore the neighboring branches. No need to pass by the ground. The squirrel glider is equipped with a membrane of skin that connects the wrists to the ankles and that stretches enough for him to glide between 2 trees. On the peaceful waters that bathe Kangaroo Island, the black swans have made a stopover. In a few hours, they will take off and land on a lake or a pond where they can stuff themselves on aquatic grasses. Several couples separate themselves on the blue of the sea. They are united for life. In the coolness of an ordinary morning, Yam, the gray kangaroo, suckles his mother, Burka. With kangaroos, the relation between mother and child is intimate and durable. Born at term after 30 days gestation. Following this, Yam entered the pouch of Burka, where he grasped one of four teats. 9 months later, the pouch could not hold him any longer. The teat, precisely that one which he had originally chosen, then became distended so he could continue to suckle from the outside. Little by little, the young kangaroo must move away from his past. Soon, for example, he must be weaned from his mother. But nothing will take away from him the nostalgia of the felt-like cocoon where he spent the start of his life. Yam would like never to grow up, and this will be his tragedy. The great wind of the South Australian basin suddenly makes the top of the eucalyptus dance. The green fleece of the island starts to tremble. The kingdom of the koalas topples like an imbalanced world. For Mako, the dominant male, it's a perplexing day. Something is happening inside of him to render him hesitant, unassured on the branch. The leaf is elusively fluttering away, and the koala, lacking all appetite, does not even try to trap it. Mako sits down on a branch. He observes the world and doesn't seem to recognize it. Everything seems strange to him. Nevertheless, he must continue to live, to scratch, to pass from trunk to trunk, as if nothing was bothering him. Mako explores his domain with the aid of the most effective instrument at his disposal, his nose. The nose of a koala is anatomically complex, disproportionate, covered in a fine leather, irrigated by a multitude of nerves and blood vessels. This sensor helps him recognize his surroundings, his fellow koalas, and his favorite leaves, the aroma of which have helped him regain his appetite. Not far from a couple of wallabies, with which they share a habitat, Yam and his mother Burka were lying down in order to proceed with their grooming. From time to time, Yam confirms that the wallabies are not showing more exuberance than they should. During this time, Burka is in the process of grooming her arms. The fingers of her hand are not opposite to her thumb. The capacities to manipulate for a kangaroo are considerably reduced. Under the watch of Burka, a wallaby is taking off. the heart of the Great Red Desert, where their father, Paraji, has established his territory, Waka and Kintala explore the possibilities of a game that the environment can offer them. They are at an age where everything, even a simple bush, can pique their curiosity. And the game is called Invent the Universe. Kintala, the young male, is wary of water. He knows it makes you wet and that it refreshes and that you can drink it. But he doesn't like that it shimmers and can hide the trappings of life. He ventures out step by step, but the fascination is stronger than his prudence. Waka is like the water, provocative. She stimulates her brother, excites him, and encourages him to launch himself, sometimes in her place, into the most risky adventures. Contrary to other canines, the dingo swims only rarely. But he takes pleasure in splashing and wading about, in playing with the water showers that gush from his body. The game is necessary for Waka, the female with the broken ear, and her brother, Kintala. It builds up character, although their past life has already contributed to this. Waka and Kintala were born 8 months earlier in an opossum's burrow that their mother had widened. She took care to choose one situated close to a source of water, so that when the puppies had need, they could regurgitate in their mouths several gulps of water. The litter was 5 puppies, but soon the dominant female of the pack didn't accept other litters other than her own from reaching maturity, and she started to slit the throats of her competitors' puppies. Waka and Kintala survived the infanticide, but were forced after weaning to go into exile with their father, Paraji. He desired, therefore, to leave the group in order to found his own territory. There were 3 that left. The pack that they formed was pathetic, vis-a-vis so big a desert. On Kangaroo Island, Kakira the koala is resting in the fork of a eucalyptus. Stuck to her like an excess piece of a fur coat, her baby is hanging onto her hindquarters. The young animal wants to become mobile, but his movements are still unassured, and the body of his mother that he must climb resembles a cliff too abrupt. Little by little, the baby discovers that nature has equipped his forearms with inordinately large muscles, his hands with claws that serve as clamps. Like his mother, he is destined to be at one with the tree, and his morphology is adapted to his arboreal. Kakira's baby is still nursing, but now in a particular manner. Excrement rejected by his mother. This fecal matter contains bacteria that will settle in his digestive tract and will permit him, when he's weaned, to digest eucalyptus leaves. The young koala soon falls asleep. Sleep is the activity to which, throughout its life, it will devote the most time. But at this age, the least little noise can bring him back to the world of the awake. He moves anew over the body of his mother, modifies his position, and finally settles in a spot where everything will annoy him. All is in its place. The mother and child form only one ball of fur, attached to the tree like a large, fluffy fruit. No one knows how many individuals form a family of kangaroos. With her invisible baby, Kartanya, for example, counts as two. Not far from her, Yam grazes close to their mother, Burka. Kartanya, like the other members of the family, tries to get rid of parasites that settle in her fur. In this season, it's a vain task without ending, and one which hounds her all the same. Burka arranges the wrinkles of her pouch. As soon as this takes place, Yam adopts a behavior of wanting to suckle. The young kangaroo extracts one of the four teats that is stretched out so that he can manipulate it. While he sucks, Burka licks behind his ears, a ritual gesture that expresses her maternal instinct. Burka can sense that her son should have already given up his milk for more stimulating vegetal nourishment. Something is wrong. She must place a deadline on this dependence. For the first time in his life, Burka starts to push her son away. Yam remains dumbfounded, almost petrified. Burka rearranges the fur of her pouch and smooths the internal compartment as if she suddenly desired to build a sanctuary. Greatly vexed, Yam falls back on the food which from now on is intended for him to eat. Thorny foliage, so harsh to the palate and that he dislikes so much. Mako, the koala, whose behavior had become erratic, seems to have rediscovered his muscle tone and some of his appetite. So much for appearances. In reality, the victim of an infectious disease, the animal has lost an eye. His illness is caused by a bacteria known as chlamydia. This illness provokes problems with the urinary and pulmonary tracts and results in a progressive destruction of eyesight. It is principally transmitted by sexual intercourse, and coupled with stress and a destruction of their environment, puts the koala on the endangered species list. From the high point of a cliff, a wallaroo seems to contemplate the empire where his kind reigns, the marsupials. Wallaroos, wallabies, kangaroos, wombats, numbats, bandicoots, koalas, opossums. They have conquered the continent, their plains and their mountains, as well as their forests or their deserts. Below, another wallaroo already reaches a watering hole. Another will join him. Then another, and still another. Like this troop of marsupials who have offered the great island continent the most famous icons. The method of reproduction for these animals differs fundamentally from that of other mammals. After a brief gestation period, a marsupial gives birth to an unfinished baby, which must complete its embryonic development in a pouch on the exterior of this reproductive apparatus. On the other hand, it's after a long gestation period that the mammal is called placental and is brought into the world as a baby already formed. Which of these strategies is the best? No one could say. We only know that marsupials invest less time and energy in the gestation period, and this allows the females to produce a new embryo faster if the first one does not survive. When the world became separated into several continental plates, Australia became a refuge for marsupials, the oldest of which had been here for 100 million years, originating from the region which today is called America. The last continent offered to the marsupials a land where predators did not abound like in the rest of the world. And so they adapted themselves, developed, and diversified. Like a wallaroo at the side of a watering hole, so longingly hoping that they have found their paradise. A black kite plots large orbs in the sky over the desert. This bird is similar to the falcon in that he is a cleaner. He feeds himself the scraps that even the vultures have not wanted. His presence is noted by the dingoes, for these latter sometimes leave him some cartilage or bone marrow that they don't want to stock. Paraji and his two children enjoy a stretch of smooth water in this region where they have not worn out their resources. Here, everything is a motivation for playing, for exploring, for confronting the world. Like always, it's Waka, the little female, who rushes head-on into the adventure. She seems certain that her father will have leniency for her indulgences. On the other hand, Paraji insists on evidence of perfect submission from his son, Kintala. He doesn't hesitate to knock him over and let him feel his breath on his neck, a sign of domination. Kintala is easily tempted and compensates for this by exercising a certain ascendancy over his sister, Waka. But she rolls on the ground, more for pleasure than from weakness. And once again, Paraji has started to treat his son harshly. He will know that from now on, the spirit that created the world on the screen of dreams forgot to invent at the same time a common practice for dingoes, justice and equity. At present, Kintala, harassed by his sister, refuses to play and rubs up against he who never punishes or rejects him, the desert. Paraji is weary. It is time for him to go somewhere else. He must verify that no suspect odor betrays the presence of a stranger on the territory. He must reassure himself that one allied pack has not arrived in view to provoke a collective hunt. He must hope that a female is starting to roam about not far where he will know to go look for a companion. Here, even for a dingo, time is precious. The great bird of prey glides again and lands as a sentinel, guarding the outposts of Mount Artula. Day is completed in this season of grace and softness. It's the time where the young blood of this continent, of all continents, the most recently formed, colorizes in red the transparent air. As if the sacred mount communicated to the flamboyant sun. As if, like it happened at the origins of the world, these immeasurable exchanges of energy, as if the rock made everything that lives here again, the crash of the creation.